Thank you for the introduction and hi everybody and greetings from Finland. So yeah, this time I will present the research that we conducted at FGI. We all work at the Department of Geoinformatics and Cartography, and Juha, Oksanen is leading that department, and yeah, I'm a senior researcher. And although I'm presenting this stuff here, then all the actual work was actually done by Anna Brauer, and she also made her diploma to the Technical University of Dresden on this same topic. So she did all the hard work. Yeah, let's get that out of the way. Here is approximate content of this presentation. Let's see how well I managed to follow that. So first, some motivation why we did what we did, and then about materials and methods, results, and finally some conclusions. So I don't know, this might be a little bit preaching to the choir, but let's go through it anyway. So traffic in cities is, to my personal opinion, is quite bad. And one reason is that there is lots of pollution coming from too many cars. And it's not just pollution for the whole climate, but also pollution for the quality of the air in the city. So for this, cycling would be a very nice green alternative, sometimes even faster, depending on the traffic situation. And it does have some beneficial health effects. So promoting cycling is really good motivation. And the problem is that most cities, if not all cities, are not really planned for cycling. Some cities are much better suitable than others, but I would say that usually they have designed for the cars. So there are no proper cycling lanes, and in my opinion, driving inside or in the car traffic is dangerous and completely mad. And but in this work, we are going to think about the cycling traffic and how it flows or how it doesn't flow in the current infrastructure, and how we could detect the worst places for the cycling and maybe help the situation in that way. Okay, so to the materials. The main data that enabled this research was data set of over 50,000 cycling tracks recorded in a mobile sports tracking application. And we got this data from the company. We made a specific contract. And just to be clear, we did not get all the data. We only get the data that the users of the application were or had set public anyway. So basically you can see the data on the website, or at least used to be able to see it, but we got it straight from the company. And the data is only GPS trajectories and some pseudo identifier. So we know which tracks come from the same user, but we don't know anything about those users. And we only get data from the Helsinki metropolitan area. Then we also need street network for our research, and we for that used OpenStreetMap street features. And then for some sanity check of our results later, we got, or there is traffic light data available for Helsinki in Helsinki region InfoShare, which we also used. Then to the actual methods. So here are, I guess, six bullets that constitute for the main parts of the our method. And I will go through them quickly, not too much in the details. So first, what we do for the trajectory data, we apply trajectory smoothing, basic Gaussian smoothing, and then we map match those to the street network. And I will not go into too much details of these because these are very well established methods. But I will just maybe comment that it's difficult to actually decide what how to smooth or process this data, because surely the application has already done some kind of smoothing or some pre-processing. So we don't really know what would be the best way to enhance this data, but this method seemed to be working quite well, so we ended up using that. Then about the street network. So the features in the open street map data can be very different lengths, and later we will aggregate different attributes to the street segment. So we wanted to get more or less uniform target for this aggregation. So we cut the street features into approximately 10, 25 meters, not longer than that, of course, shorter features can be found. But then maybe stop detection, something that we want to discuss in a bit more detail. So we are interested to find out, first of all, where the cyclist, when they are traveling inside the city, where are the places that they often need to stop? Because this is usually something that nobody while traveling doesn't want to stop without a good reason. So here is a really simplified picture of how we are doing this stuff. So here is depicted GPS trajectory. See, coming from the left, the green points show that the cyclist is moving nicely. And then there is something happening that he or she needs to stop. And there is that kind of point cluster happening. And then at some point, cyclist can all begin to move on, and we get more or less these green points. So to detect these kind of stops, we applied again well-established algorithm CV, SMOT. Forgot the reference here, but you can find it in the paper. So it doesn't work exactly in this picture, but the idea is that it will find stops and separate them from the sort of moving parts of the trajectories. So we do this analysis for every trajectory, and all the stops that we find, we then find the closest street network and sort of relate this stop to that street network segment. And we, for every stop, we calculate the stop duration. And then when we aggregate all the stops from all the trajectories, we can get average stop duration and sort of probability that cyclist needs to stop if he or she travels through this segment. And just for later, we also save all these stops to another separate list. But more on that later. Okay, so that was about stops. Then we also are more interested in the more dynamic aspects of the movement. So basically speed, acceleration, and then something called speed ratio, which I will explain again. So here's the same trajectory, but now we are interested on the parts that where the cyclist is actually moving. So we just from the neighboring points define speed and acceleration for the GPS points. And then when we have find out these sort of moving parts of the trajectory, we can calculate what is the average moving or traveling speed of this specific cyclist. And with that, we can calculate the average. Oh, I think I said it already. Yeah, we get the average average speed of this trajectory, and then we can sort of for every point we can get the speed, but we also get the relative speed, or we call it here speed ratio. And we need this because there are many different cyclists. For example, some athletic cyclists can go very fast compared to some let's say what we call Sunday cyclists, so somebody not moving very fast and maybe with not so great bike. Even though both may be going as fast as they want, then their absolute speed will be very different. And to tackle this, we use the speed ratio. So sort of relative to the average speed of the trajectory. So in ideal case, it should be, let's say, quite close to one. And when there is really nice straight segments, it should be higher than one. And when there is something where the cyclist cannot go as fast as he or she would like, it goes lower than one. And then when we define these for each of these points, we can also aggregate for each street segments, average speed, speed ratio, and acceleration. Yeah, I think that was that. And then we come to this funny thing called cycling traffic fluency. None of us who were doing this work are native English speakers, so this term for us was really fine. But then at some point we heard that fluency, you cannot use fluency in this context, that it's only language. So I apologize for all the native English speakers if this hurts your ears. I try not to use it too much. But let's see what this actually means. So we have these four attributes: speed ratio, acceleration for the street segments, and then also stop duration and stop ratio, or let's say probability of having to make a stop on the segment. And somehow we would like to go combine all of these into one number that tells how nice this specific segment is for cycling. And for speed ratio and acceleration, we decided to use sort of transformation functions. For speed ratio, which usually fluctuates around one, we use this sort of sigmoid function that normalizes the value between 0 and 1, where 0 is really bad for cycling and 1 is really good for cycling. And then for the acceleration, that was a little bit more tricky. We used this kind of peak around 0. So if the acceleration is less than 0, which means that it's slowing down, this index gets penalized. But then also if it's higher than 1, so if there's actually speed gain, we also penalize for that. And this is a little bit counterintuitive maybe, but the idea is that cyclists would preferably like to go with constant speed, and whenever there is some change, it means that something is not as the cyclist would like. So that's why the peak value of 1 is when there is no acceleration at all. And these we combined moving index by taking the harmonic mean of these two values for each street segment. And we use very similar approach to mean stop duration and stop ratio. Here we decided to use categorization instead of some continuous function, but I don't remember why we chose it like this, but you could use some similar transformation function. It doesn't matter too much. And also these we combine into iStop or stop index. And then when we have these two indices, we combine them to one index, which we define cycling traffic fluency index. And as you can already see that there is lots of moving parts, for example, how to choose these transformation functions or categorization. And I will also comment on that later. But then what is left here is just how to evaluate what we calculated, do they make any sense? So like I said, we have traffic light data. We will compare the stops. And we assume that there's some correlation between the traffic lights. And then we also use cycling traffic data, which was not part of this original data set, to compare this average speed and attributes. So first results, this is about the stops. and specifically the stop hotspots. So what you see on this map, it's not every stop from every trajectory, but they are clustered into clusters. What a surprise. And let's say smallest clusters have been removed. So only the significant clusters are put here. And then the color tells which was the which is the probable cause of that stop. So if the stop hotspot is closer than now I forgot the distance, but some distance from the traffic light, we will say that okay, traffic light is the cause of this stop. If there was no traffic light, but there was intersection close anyway, then we divide or we say that intersection was the reason for the stop. And if none of this applied, then we just call it other. We cannot really say why these stop clusters happen. And well, it's nice to see that there is quite good correlation with the traffic light and intersection. So at least it's not completely out of the reality what we got from this analysis. So we can say that the stop analysis is somewhat reliable. Then here is about this dynamic attributes. So we took one, or maybe of course we took many, but here is one cycling trajectory from volunteer, and we calculated this speed rate. Trajectory was passing, and to me this was surprisingly good correlation with the aggregated data. So this suggested also these dynamical attributes, they are somehow related to the reality and not just numbers on the database. Then next slide is really new. So the problem is that, for example, here on the left, you now see the cycling traffic fluency index visualized in the central Helsinki. And we see there are lots of darker colors, so bad CTF index in the big junction cross sections. But then there are also very light values when there is not so much intersection. But then the problem is that how do we compare this to reality? What reference data can we use to say, does this make any sense? And just found out yesterday that 1 month ago there was a questionnaire in Helsinki where citizens could indicate where they think that there is bad cycling roads and also other things in this data. So this is very preliminary, but at least some comparison can be done. So I don't know if you can see my mouse cursor, but at least we can see that these clear dark features on the right, then we can also see them on this CTF index. I was really happy that there at least seems to be some kind of correlation. Of course, we cannot expect one-to-one comparison because these are not the same data. The CTF index on the left, it's not really dependent on the popularity of the street. On the right, this hotspot probably, there is quite high correlation of where most cyclists go. So we should not even expect any kind of total correlation, but at least they don't disagree. That's really good. Okay, and then it's time for conclusions. So I presented here a new method that we developed that can be used to use big cycling trajectory data for benefit of citizens. And we did some comparison of our calculated results to reality or situation in the street. And we see that our results seem to be reasonable. Then there are lots of moving parts. So this, how this index is calculated, it can be changed in many different ways. And maybe it's utopic to think that we can actually define one index, one number that tells if one street segment is really good for cyclists or not. But maybe this can be tuned for different, for example, different kind of cyclists. For example, different index for athletes and different index for just somebody going to local shop. And our really idea or dream is that we could provide something for the companies that companies would like to share their data and sort of get some kind of positive feedback loop going on, and in the end get better cities for cycling. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Phil. Just if we could hold our virtual applause for the moment, and please do post any questions you have. First one from James. How do you use your metrics to predict journey time for someone traveling in a new city? So based on cyclists with similar profiles in that city.
Did you say journey time?
Yeah. So.
Yes, I think you could, because this, well, I saw the speed ratio, then yeah, maybe. I'm not saying it's not impossible, but I'm not actually sure how well it is. I would say maybe.
No, I like the idea, and I suppose it's kind of focused around creating a profile for you as a cyclist and matching it to others. Another question from Andreas Keller. Have you inspected the relationship with public transport, for example, bus prioritization? What is the format of the traffic light data signal plans?
No, we haven't done anything like that. And, one problem is that the data contract is now over, so at this point we cannot really continue with this stuff. We don't have access to the raw data anymore.
Kind of on that note, did you get any feedback from the data provider? Did they kind of find what you'd done useful? Was it something they kind of were interested in?
What to say about that? We are discussing. Okay. Right, mm-hmm. No, that's what I'm guessing.
Okay, fair enough. No, that's fine. One other question I had was, you talked about the stop clusters and then the traffic lights or the intersections, and then there were the kind of others that weren't traffic lights or intersections. Did you have a look at any individual ones, and do you know what caused them?
Yeah, we did some field work, and I mean Anna did. So we could identify, for example, there is stairs that most cyclists don't want to travel, that they maybe have to stop and carry their bike, or there can be some metro station that maybe people have to stop and wait for some kind of traffic, or I don't know what, but nothing one clear reason, but always something that maybe this could be the reason, but it's hard to say exactly.
Great. Yang Zhang has asked a question. I'm wondering about validating the results. How might we go about doing that?
Yeah, I mean, that is the biggest problem, I would say, we have. That, of course, we can calculate whatever numbers we get, but we want, but then how to correlate that to reality is always really difficult. So we did this top analysis and comparing the independent trajectories that were not part of the original data. And they suggest that the numbers make some sense, but then for this CTF, final CTF index, then it's something that we are still thinking about how to really, well, it's not even about validating, because we are not saying that that's something that is in reality, but how to say that this makes sense, then it's really difficult.
Yeah.
We are thinking about it.
Yeah, I think the questionnaire and the results from that are kind of a useful part. So that's a good sign.
Yeah, and I have to say, it was not about, we didn't do that. Maybe I didn't mention it, but it was I think City of Helsinki that did it. I just happened to notice it yesterday that kind of data came out.
Okay, yeah, great. Well spotted. Do you, I suppose one kind of other question is, do you, well, firstly, is the code for the method available, and could it then be replicated in other cities?
I think right now the code is not published, but I think that we will maybe publish it. It should not be a problem. And then about transferability to other cities, then one reason we used OpenStreetMap is that you should find that from many different cities. Mm-hmm. But then of course, some cities can be a little bit different traffic rules, and cities that are better suited for cyclists or have some specific bike lanes that bike lanes that Helsinki doesn't have, then maybe some tweaking needs to be done. But in general, there is no, it's designed to work anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. And for Helsinki, were there any bike lanes in your data, and did that come out differently to kind of normal road traffic?
Yeah, there are some, for example, only dedicated lines for biking, and you can sort of see that they are, at least they are not completely black in the CTF map, but they didn't stand out as much as I originally thought. But we are still exploring the results, so